I was diagnosed with IgG kappa, stage 3 multiple myeloma. The multiple myeloma was in over 99% of my bone marrow. I started treatment immediately. The treatment back in 2008 are very different than now. And in the beginning, I had a tough time. The treatments were not touching my myeloma. I had initial success, but then it stopped working. I had a stem cell transplant, and that didn't work. And I was devastated. I really didn't think I was going to live much longer. And luckily, a treatment that my doctor suggested began working for me. And it worked so well that I put my disease in a remission. And since probably about 2010, I've been on maintenance therapy and able to live my life. And in the meantime, I retired from teaching because I didn't know what I was going to be doing. And now I'm a different person. And that's what today's conversation is about. We're going to be talking to two myeloma specialists about the latest happenings for the newly diagnosed population coming out of a meeting that was called ASH. Usually, newly diagnosed is broken up into two groups, transplant eligible and transplant ineligible. And before we even start talking about what's happening in that area, how are those defined? Like, how do you know if I'm a transplant eligible patient or ineligible?
Good question. And actually a bit of a moving target. We used to kind of say that transplant eligible or transplant ineligible, which I should say is usually kind of assigned at the time of diagnosis. So a patient first gets diagnosed with multiple myeloma, the oncologist, you at least historically kind of got just kind of a gestalt or a gut instinct to say this patient is younger, older, healthier, less healthy, what we call a performance status, a good performance status, meaning that they're independent with their activities of daily living. They can bathe themselves. They live alone. They do their own grocery shopping, you know, whatever it is. Historically, we'd look at a patient and say, healthy, not healthy, old, young, and kind of make kind of, just generic assignments to people. And that's really challenging to do when someone's first diagnosed with myeloma, because many times when you're first diagnosed, you're sick. You don't feel good. You've spent months kind of trying to figure out what's going on. It may have taken a while to get the diagnosis. At that point, many bones have been affected by myeloma. It can be very painful. And a lot of people just aren't all the things that we think of what normal health is, let's say. So traditionally, we have made assignments when patients were first diagnosed to say, you're healthy enough, strong enough, well enough that you can get an intensive regimen called a bone marrow transplant or not. Now, I will say, though, I think there's been a bit of an evolution to the concept of transplant eligibility as some more data has kind of emerged to say, does everyone have to get a transplant? Where maybe we don't need to use those same kind of assignments to make that determination. And so I would argue to say, I think the better way to distinguish between patients who may be able to get a transplant and patients who may not is frailty. So frailty is a little bit more of an objective as opposed to a subjective means of evaluating someone's health and independence and really kind of help identify those patients who may be candidates for more intensive therapy throughout their myeloma kind of diagnosis, we'll say, and their treatment. So that is kind of where we've landed on transplant eligibility and ineligibility. But the concept is do we think people are well enough to undergo a bone marrow transplant?
So now let's talk about that group of transplant ineligible patients, people who might be not strong enough for their body to endure this treatment. What is, first of all, the most common type of treatment that this group of people usually get?
So a bit of an evolution as well. I mean, what a wonderful problem that we've had so many new drugs developed in multiple myeloma. And when drugs do get developed, first they are approved for patients who have had many prior treatments and they're looking for the next newest and greatest. And that's usually how the FDA approves these drugs. They approve it and say, let's just start with this group of patients. But over the years, it gets tested with more and more patients earlier on in their diagnosis. So one of the things that patients with newly diagnosed myeloma who are not planning or not eligible or too frail to go to transplant have enjoyed is the addition of daratumumab to the first treatment you receive when you're diagnosed. So daratumumab, I like to describe, is a bit of a magnet, if you will. So we think of it, it's technically called a monoclonal antibody. But what it is a medicine that predominantly is given as a shot. And that medicine is injected. It is particularly looking for a sign on the myeloma cells that says, hey, this is me. And when it finds it, like a magnet sticks to it and helps pop it open. And it pops it open with a, you know, different, many different approaches, but it's a real kind of targeted, you know, targeted treatment and uses your immune system to help kill as well. So I really have seen daratumumab kind of evolve into the gift that keeps on giving because it really has helped so many patients in various time points in their disease. Now being so effective, why wait? Why can't we use it when patients are first diagnosed? So that has really now, I think, turned into the optimal treatment as a basis for when older, frailer, weaker, less healthy people, let's say, are diagnosed with myeloma. So, but remember, we like to use multiple drugs. I think of it as like the old game of Clue, right? Instead of just using a handle stick or a revolver or a lead pipe, you know, we want to use all the tools we have together as a cocktail so that we can approach the myeloma and sneak up on it and kill it from different ways. So daratumumab is great in combination with many different treatments. And so I'd say the front runner right now for patients like you describe is the combination of daratumumab with good old lenalidomide, also known as Revlimid, plus or minus dexamethasone, which is something that we'll get to.
So the Maya trial was trying to see for the ineligible patients if two is better than three. For the transplant eligible patients, I know the question is three better than four? Should we be adding DARA to RVD? And, you know, the one thing I guess that keeps on coming up is the quality of life issues. So can we talk a little bit about, you know, three versus four in the newly diagnosed transplant eligible population?
Of course. So you asked the right question. So yes, if we've proved three is better than two medicines together, it brings up the next natural question, well, is four better? And that question is trying to answer if adding daratumumab to another group of patients who have just been diagnosed with myeloma, but let's say that this is a younger, stronger, healthier group of people who we have historically treated with three medicines called lenalidomide, bortezomib, and dexamethasone. For the last many years, that combination of those three drugs has kind of been the mainstay. It's been the most widely accepted, most successful treatment that we've been able to achieve ever. And so, but we need to always do better. And so the Griffin study was a study that looked at patients who were younger, healthier, stronger, whatever, going to go to transplant. The decision was made, you are going to get transplant, and divided it in half and said, I'm going to give you three medicines like we always do. This is the current standard of care, or I'm going to give this other half four medicines. So the same treatments that the first three got, the Revlimid, Velcade, Dex, and add the daratumumab to it for a group of four. And all the patients got the treatment that they were assigned to. All the patients subsequently had a bone marrow transplant. After the transplant, all the patients got maintenance. But depending on, I should say, even say consolidation and maintenance, which just means a little extra therapy after your transplant, followed by some amount of maintenance therapy, which is usually either fewer drugs or lower doses as a means of maintaining the successes you've had from all the treatments prior. And by comparing four drugs to three drugs for this group, again, DARA keeps winning. We see that the daratumumab really is effective, again, at deepening response, killing more myeloma, making it get into remission more likely, allowing patients to get back to themselves, to get stronger, and to continue on some amount of medicine that's going to allow the myeloma to kind of stay in remission in very deep ways. So again, seeing the same outcomes we saw in Maya, that the addition of DARA to our standard of care allows for great successes that last.
Do you think that the four drug combination is going to be the new standard of care for newly diagnosed myeloma patients?
I don't think will. I think is. I'm already doing it. So it's hard to ignore the data when it's that good. Now, granted, the reason I think why you're asking the question is because the trial that was done was technically what's called a phase two trial, where a lot of drug development and new combinations, you know, the people that kind of are the most critical of statistics and evaluating successes are the ones that really want to see what we call big studies, phase three trials, randomized data, where you're comparing the standard to something, you know, new and novel. And those are happening. The same drugs, the same study, more patients, it's happening. We'll get that information. But on the same token, if I already have some information that shows me just how effective it is with a good number of people, I don't want to wait. I want to kind of do good and do well by these patients with these early successes that we're seeing now. And so I think it's here.
We have all these wonderful drugs that you've been talking about now. Can you talk a little bit about, in the era of, you know, these novel therapies, is stem cell transplant still needed initially? And what determination, you know, is telling us?
The $1 million question. It's ironic because it keeps getting asked. I think everyone is so hopeful that we can get rid of auto transplant because we have all these new medicines. And every time a new medicine comes out, the question is posed, the trial is done to say, do we still need transplant or is this better? And so that's what this trial was designed to do. It took patients who were eligible for transplant and divided them in half and gave everybody the same medicine. So our old goody, you know, triplet combination of Revlimid, Velcade, and Dex, and said, you get this and you go to transplant, you get this and you don't go to transplant. And let's see what happens between those two, with the idea of looking at, is one group going to have their myeloma come back sooner than the other group? And so when we have the determination study was kind of the US version of it. So the French had their own version, the same thing. And they're always ahead of the game with us with clinical trials. They were able to complete enrollment, get the results, publish it well before we did. And they showed that the patients who got transplant stayed in remission longer than those who didn't. But after looking at the data for a handful of years, what they saw was that there was no difference in how long people lived for. And, you know, lots of arguments about whether that is, well, A, important, and one would argue yes, two, whether enough time had passed by to say, you know, here we are, we keep applauding and patting ourselves on the back for how well these treatments are working. Maybe we haven't had the full time pass by enough to say that there's going to be a great difference in survival or not. And so when the Americans did theirs, the only subtle minor difference was that after transplant, patients stayed on Revlimid maintenance indefinitely as long as the maintenance was working. If they did not go to transplant, they stayed on Revlimid as long as it was working, which was different from the French. They only took it for 12 months and then stopped. And there were a good number of people who stopped therapy and were off and never had progression for 6-7 years, whatever it is. But what the American kind of side of the trial showed was similar. The transplant group stayed in remission longer. The survival was no different, but there did seem to be improved time to staying in remission because we think of the longer lasting use of the maintenance Revlimid. And so, you know, I think it begs the question to say, is it that we need to get rid of transplant, or is it that transplant is complementary? They have, you know, parsed through that data left, right, and up and down to try and understand, you know, well, was it the blondes who did better, or was it the African Americans who did better, or someone who had different kidney function do better, and tried really to see, is it a general statement we can make across the board? I think the thing that was the most helpful for me to try and parse through whether or not transplant was important or still has a role, while I would love to know that it saves lives, let me hearken back to the first cut is the deepest comment. Because if we are really trying to make a deep impact in myeloma when it's first diagnosed, with the presumption that that's going to allow for the longest periods of remission until the next newest and greatest comes out, then it's pretty clear the way they parse the data to say that those who had transplant were more likely to get to what we call MRD negativity, minimal residual disease, which is that way under the surface. We have lots of tricks to count myeloma. I can do a bone marrow biopsy and send it to my pathologist, and they look under the microscope and say, yep, I see it. Nope, I don't. But in 2023, shouldn't we have super high tech, you know, high technology that can look for myeloma in the smallest little micron of DNA? And we want to try and get rid of every last bit of myeloma, because those patients, we can tell time and time again now, are the ones who are staying in remission the longest. So the determination study was helpful for me to say, we're not saving lives. We're not letting people, as far as we know, live longer because of doing a transplant. But we are having patients stay in remission by doing it. And, you know, maybe we need more time to pass by. Maybe we don't. But I think for the meantime, transplant really seems to me, disclaimer, I'm a transplanter, that it's complementary. I think it works with our novel agents, not better or worse than our novel agents. Maybe we can try and figure out if our initial treatments didn't do the job, maybe that's the group of people who should proceed. So stay tuned, lots to come.
And I think that with the results of the determination study, that it's pretty clear to me that even with good drugs, transplant continues to offer benefit. Now, there are a lot of folks that say, well, if you're MRD negative at cycle 4, maybe you don't need the transplant. We actually don't have any data that says that. And from my perspective, my goal is to maximize the duration of that first remission, because the myeloma is never more sensitive than it is at the time of the first presentation. And by the time it relapses once or twice, you may lose the ability to gain the benefit from high-dose therapy, a really high-dose melphalan. And so, you know, certainly at our center, we encourage patients to go into transplant in the first remission. The field is moving really fast. Things are changing once or twice or three times or 10 times a year. You know, we've had multiple drugs approved in the last 4 years, even through COVID, we still saw drug approvals. And so I think that the field is moving fast enough that if you have a really good general oncologist, they may be able to keep up to date, but they may not know the latest and greatest. And for that reason, I think having a myeloma center of record, if you will, a place that's close to you, a team you feel comfortable with that can partner with your local oncologist, really guarantees that you're getting access to the latest and greatest, not just agents or combinations, but that your team knows what approaches are going to be the most forward-thinking approaches to keep you going for the longest period of time.